The general law with regard to claiming for retrospective application of the law, the settled law is there. We have two types of legislations, which are substantive legislations, procedural laws. Substantive law will give certain vested rights, so that cannot be made applicable retrospectively. The procedural laws can always be made retrospective, but finally, it is the legislative intent that should be expressed very clearly. In the absence of legislative intent, the interpretation of law is very clear that you have to make the law that should work as intended. You believe that when the legislature makes the law, they have the intention to make it like that. So you should not add or delete the words unless they result in absurdity. That was the general law. So we are moving. That is why the Honorable Supreme Court, to justify they are checking whether there is any legislative intent is there. Now here they went into the situation, Tirumalai Chemicals Limited versus Union of India. It is observed that para 23 observed that it is right law that every statute is prospective unless it is expressly or by necessary implication made to have retrospective operation. This proposition has been reiterated in Purbanchal Cables and Conductors Private Limited. Para 51 of the said order of the Honorable Supreme Court, there is no doubt about the fact that Act is a substantive law, as vested rights of entitlement to a higher rate of interest in case of delayed payment accrues in favor of the supplier, and corresponding liability is imposed on the buyer. This court time and again has observed that any substantive law shall operate prospectively unless retrospective operation is clearly made out in the language of the statute. Only a procedural or declaratory law operates retrospectively, as there is no vested rights in procedure. Then in CIT versus Vatika Township Private Limited, in paragraph 29, the court observed that the obvious basis of the principle against retrospectivity is the principle of fairness, which must be the basis of every legal rule, as was observed in Chefian Desperate Yamashita Sinhalan Steamship. Thus, legislation which modified accrued rights, on which impose obligations or impose new duties or attach a new disability, have to be treated as prospective unless the legislative intent is clearly to give the enactment a retrospective effect. Unless the legislature is for purpose of supplying an obvious omission in a former legislation or to explain a former legislation, it is done. We need not note that the catena of case laws available on the subject, because the aforesaid legal position clearly emerges from the various decisions, and this legal position was conceded by the counsel for the parties. In any case, we shall refer to a few judgments containing this dictatum a little later. Once again, in Vijayalakshmi Rice Mills, the new contractors company and others was a state of Andhra Pradesh, in paragraph 5, the court observed thus, para 5, Mr. Nariman, appearing on behalf of the appellants, has laid great emphasis on the word substituted, accruing in Clause 2 of the Rice Control Third Amendment Order 1964, and has argued that the claim of the appellants cannot be validly ignored. Elaborating his submission, counsel has submitted that as the price fixed by the government are meant for the entire season, the appellants have to be paid at the controlled price as fixed while the Rice Control Third Amendment Order, regardless of the dates on which the supplies were made. We cannot accede to this contention. It is no doubt true that The literal meaning of the word substitute is to replace. But the question before us is, from which date the substitution or replacement of the new schedule took effect? There is no deeming clause or some such provision in the Rice Price Control Act to indicate that it was intended to have retrospective effect. It is a well-recognized rule of interpretation that in the absence of express words or appropriate language from which retrospectivity may be inferred, a notification takes effect from the date it is issued and not from any prior date. The principle is also well settled that statutes should not be construed so as to create new disabilities or obligations or impose new duties in respect of transactions which were complete at the time of the Amendment Act came into force. In para 56, BK Educational, the court was called upon to consider the question as to whether Limitation Act 1963 will apply to applications that are made under Section 7 or 9 of the Code on and from the commencement of 1/12/2016 till 2018. That question was examined in the context of Section 238A inserted in INB Code by the Self-Name Amendment Act of 2018. The court, after adverting to the contents of the report of the Insolvency Law Committee of March 2018 and the provisions of the code and other enactment, opined that Section 238A was clarificatory in nature and, being a procedural law, came to hold that it had retrospective effect. The court held that taking any other view would result in an incongruous situation, as the provisions of the Limitation Act would apply in some set of cases to be decided by the same tribunal and not in other set of cases. Besides, the court adverted to the principle that right to sue accrues on the date when the default occurs, and if the default occurred even 3 years prior to the date of filing of the application, the same cannot be treated as a debt that is due and payable or the debt due. Now here recently the NCLT Mumbai has given certain opinion. Suppose in section in balance sheet, if you are going to declare the debt as payable, of course here it is debt due is different from debt due and payable. So when you are showing in the balance sheet, what does it mean? You are going to show it is in the debtor side of the balance sheet. So these are the this is the debt due, that is the liability side of the balance sheet. You have to show as a creditor. So it is a liability means anything that is payable. And a strict interpretation, how is it should be taken from the Limitation Act? Now this should be under Section 18 of the Limitation Act. Whether to be treated as acknowledgement when that is put in the shown in the balance sheet as acknowledgement of debt, and therefore the Limitation Act Section 18 applies and then you are absolved from that, or it is a liability due but not payable. But not payable means why do you show in the balance sheet is the issue that is going to emerge. So the Limitation Act is when the, suppose I keep showing that liability and then the law expires, then I should have written off that debt not payable in the books of account. By showing that as a debt due and you are acknowledging the liability is going to be the future arguments. Let us see how things go on. But here one thing is clear. The Limitation Act is a procedural act. They are taking the stand. Whereas this 75% to 66% is a substantive right is what the Honorable Supreme Court has decided. In para 57, in the case of State Bank of India, the court considered the question as to whether Section 14 of the INB Code, which provides for moratorium for the period mentioned in the code, insolvency would apply to a personal guarantor of the corporate debtor. Even in this judgment, the court, after adverting to all the relevant materials and governing provisions of the code, concluded that amended section 14 was only clarificatory in nature to set at rest what the committee thought was an overboard interpretation of section 14. On that reasoning, the court concluded that amendment to section 14 had retrospective effect. Because the appellants justified that this, say, 66% should be looked at retrospectively by citing the Limitation Act and the section 230 8A, and also in section 14 of IMB code in State Bank of India. In the present case, however, the amendment under consideration pertaining to section 30 subsection B is to modify the voting share threshold for decisions of the COC and cannot be treated as clarificatory in nature. It changes the qualifying standards for reckoning the decision of the COC concerning the process of approval of the resolution plan. So it is very, very simple that how the Supreme Court is looking at very correctly, I think so, though there is a scope. I say CA Institute, the threshold of limit is 50%, and 5 years have gone, so many people could not reach and failed it. Then Supreme CA Institute has reduced to 40%. Now that 40% cannot be claimed to apply retrospectively, and they should apply prospectively. That is how the entire judgment is centered at. In our view, no other contention raised to support the resolution plan of the concerned corporate debtor would be of any avail. Even so, we may advert to the argument regarding the effect of amendment of Regulation 39, which has come into force with effect 4th July 2018. Prior to that amendment, Regulation 39.3 merely provided that committee may approve any resolution plan with such modifications as it deems fit. This was amended by notification, and 39 says, 39.3, the committee shall evaluate the resolution plans received under subsection 1 strictly as per the evaluation matrix to identify the best resolution plan and may approve it with such modification as it deems fit, provided that committee shall record the reasons for approving or rejecting the resolution plan. So that the rejection or resolution plan came only later, based maybe this on this judgment. In the first place, amendment to regulation cannot have retrospective effect so as to impact the decision of the COC of the concerned pro-corporate debtor taken before the amendment of the said legislation. There is no indication in the code as amended or regulation to suggest that as a consequence of this amendment, the decisions already taken by the COC prior to 3rd July be treated as deemed to have been vitiated, or for that matter necessitating reversion of the proposal to COC for recording reasons, that too beyond the statutory period of 270 days. A new life cannot be infused into a result plan which did not fructify within the statutory period by such a circuitous route. Assuming that this provision was applicable to the cases on hand, non-recording of reasons for approving or rejecting the resolution plan by concerned financial creditor during the voting in the COC meeting would not render the final collective decision of COC nullity per se. Concededly, if the objection to the resolution plan is on account of infraction of grounds specified in the section 32 and 613, that must be specifically and expressly raised at the relevant time. For the approval of the resolution plan by the COC can be challenged only on these grounds. However, if the opposition to the proposed resolution plan is purely commercial or business decision, the same being non-justiciable, is not open to challenge before the adjudicating authority or, for that matter, the appellate authority. If so, non-recording of any reason for taking such commercial decision will be of no avail. In the present case, admittedly, the dissenting financial creditors have rejected the resolution plan in exercise of the business or commercial decision and not because of non-compliance of the grounds specified in section 30 subsection 2 or section 61 subsection 3. As such, resultantly, the amended regulation pressed into service will be of no avail. With regard to these Mardia Chemicals, paragraph 45, it was argued that even in regard to option exercised by the financial creditors under section 30 subsection 4, the requirement of giving reasons for approval or disapproval of the proposed resolution plan must be read into it. In that case, court had considered the mechanism specified in section 13 of the SARFAESI Act, which provided for giving a notice to the borrower, and upon receipt of such notice, the borrower could raise objections as to why the proposed action of the secured creditors was uncalled for. In that context, the court in paragraph 45 observed as an. See, SARFAESI Act also has been shown that calls for explanation, notice to be given, reasons for that decision should be made. But in the background, we have section 40, para 45 talking about SARFAESI Act. In the background, we have indicated above, we may consider as to what forums or remedies are available to the borrower to ventilate his grievance. The purpose of serving a notice upon the borrower under subsection 2 of section 13 of the Act is that a reply may be submitted by the borrower explaining the reasons as to why measures may or may not be taken under subsection 4 of section 13 in case of non-compliance with the notice within 60 days. The creditor must apply its mind to the objections raised in reply to such notice, and an internal mechanism must be particularly evolved to consider such objections raised in the reply to the notice. There may be some meaningful consideration of the objections raised rather than ritually reject them and proceed to make drastic measure under subsection 4 of the section 13 of the Act. One such a duty is envisaged on the part of the creditor, it would only be conducive to the principle of fairness on the part of the banks and financial institutions in dealing with their borrowers to apprise them of the reason for not accepting the objections on points raised in reply to the notice served upon them before proceeding to make measures under subsection 4 of section 30. Such reasons overruling the objections of the borrower must also be communicated to the borrower by the secured creditor. It will only be in the fulfillment of the requirement of the reasonableness and fairness in dealing of institutional financing, which is so important from the point of view of the economy of the country and would serve the purpose in the growth of a healthy economy. It would certainly provide guidance to the secured debtors in general in conducting the affairs in a manner that may not be found defaulting and being made liable for the unsavory steps contained under the subsection 4 of section 13. At the same time, more importantly, we must make it clear unequivocally that communication of the reasons for not accepting the objection taken by the secured borrower may not be taken to give occasion to resort to such proceedings which are not permissible under the provisions of the Act. But communication of reasons not to accept the objections of the borrower would certainly be for the purpose of his knowledge, which would be a step forward towards his right to know as to why his objections have not been accepted by a secured creditor who intends to resort to harsh steps of taking over the management and business where secured assets without intervention of the court. Such a person, in respect of whom steps under section 13(4) of the Act are likely to be taken, cannot be denied the right to know the reasons of non-acceptance and the objections. It is true, as per the provisions of this Act, he may not be entitled to challenge the reasons communicated or the likely action of the secured creditor at the point of time, unless his right to approach the debt recovery tribunal as provided under section 17 of the Act matures on any measure having been taken under section 4, subsection 4 of section 13 of the Act. In the present case, however, we are concerned with the provisions of INB code dealing with the resolution process. The dispensation provided in the INB code is entirely different In terms of Section 30 of the IP Code, the decision is taken collectively after due negotiations between the financial creditors who are constituents of the COC and thereby, and they express their opinion on the proposed resolution plan in terms of the votes, as per their voting share. In the meantime, in the meeting of COC, the proposed resolution plan is placed for discussion, and after full interaction in the presence of all concerned, the resolution professional, the constituents of COC, finally proceed to exercise their option, the business bar commercial decision, to approve or not to approve the proposed resolution plan. In such a case, non-recording of reasons would not per se vitiate the collective decision of the financial creditors. The legislature has not envisaged a challenge to commercial but business decision of the financial creditors taken collectively, or for that matter, their individual opinion, as the case may be on this count. It was then contended that NCLAT committed manifest error in not calling upon the dissenting financial creditors to respond to the applications filed in the concerned appeals pending before it, including with a prayer to allow the resolution applicant to revise the resolution plan. We find no merits in this submission. The reliefs claimed in the state application filed before NCLAT would not take the matter any further, for it is enough for the dissenting financial creditors to disapprove the proposed resolution plan by voting as per the voting share based on the commercial decision. Indeed, if the opposition of the dissenting financial creditor is in regard to matters within the jurisdiction of the tribunal under Section 30, subsection 2, or Section 61, subsection 3, then the situation may somewhat be different, but that is not an issue for discussion here. As regards the application by the resolution applicant for taking his revised resolution plan on record, the same is also devoid of merits, inasmuch as it is not open to the adjudicating authority to entertain a revised resolution plan after the expiry of the period of 270 days. Accordingly, no fault can be found with NCLAT for not entertaining the application. The counsel appearing for the resolution applicant and the stakeholders supporting the resolution plan were at pains to persuade us to exercise the powers under 142 of the Constitution. Inasmuch as in both the cases, the vote of approval exceeded more than 66% of the voting share of the financial creditors, and yet the benefit of the amended provision could not be availed of, as it came only during the pendency of the appeal before the NCLAT. The submission is that this court may set aside the order passed by the tribunal and regularly relegate the parties in both the cases before NCLT for considering the proceedings afresh. In light of the aforesaid, the amended provision reducing the threshold requirement of the present voting share of the financial creditors to 66%, we are afraid it is not possible for us to exercise the powers under Article 142 of the Constitution, which will result in issuing directions in the teeth of the provisions as applicable to the cases on hand. We therefore decline to accede to the request. Having answered the core issues and to avoid avoid proximity, we do not wish to dilate on the exposition of in the other reported decisions of the other reported decisions. As a result, the amendment, the general